Scripture today is from two books. First is from Joel, chapter 2, verses 27 through 29. Thus you will know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other, and my people will never be put to shame. It will come about this, after this, that I will pour out my spirit on all mankind, and your sons and daughters will prophesy, your old men will dream dreams, your young men will see visions. Even on the male and female servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. And now from 2 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 1 through 6. Boasting is necessary, though it is not profitable. But I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know, or out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a man was caught up to the third heaven. And I know how such a man, whether in the body or apart from the body I do not know, God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words, which a man is not permitted to speak. On behalf of such a man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except in regard to my weaknesses. For if I do wish to boast, I will not be foolish, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from this, so that no one will credit me with more than he sees in me or hears from me. And now from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 10. But when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This morning we come to a close in our series relating to our journey, recognizing that when we view our life as a continual passageway with God, the true essence of the journey never ends. Over these weeks, we've covered the formative spiritual and mortal life patterns of individuals, from those who never grow up to those who wish to live only in a bubble, to last week's assertion, which said those who think they've expanded their horizons as far as they might possibly go need to hear God's call to us today, that those of us on this side of eternity have the potential of expanding our views and capacities much further than we ever dreamed possible. But let's pause for a moment and focus in on our first lesson pertaining to those who spiritually choose to never grow up. There's a story about a Southern Baptist pastor who one day was giving a fire and brimstone sermon, telling people about sinners in the hands of an angry God. That's a great old Wesley sermon. And at the conclusion of the sermon, one gentleman came up and kneeled at the altar and prayed to receive Christ as their Lord and Savior. And the congregation was thrilled that one new soul had been brought into the kingdom of God. And the pastor marked down in his book that day, that week that that happened. And a year later, the pastor looked at him and said, "Brother, would you stand up and give us your testimony?" And the gentleman stood up and said, "One year ago to this week, I received Christ as my personal Lord and Savior." And the congregation burst forth in joy and applause. And he sat down. Another 4 years went by, and the pastor had little notations in his book of all the different things about members in his flock. And he stood up on that particular Sunday and he said, "Brother, would you please come down to the center?" And the man walked down and he said, "Would you please tell us something very special about this day?" And the man thought for a moment and he said, "Well, Pastor, I'm not really sure what I should be saying, but I do know that 5 years ago to this week, I received Christ as my personal Lord and Savior." And again, there was a bit of applause in the sanctuary, but not nearly as much as had happened the 4 years previous. Well, you know and I know that pastors come and pastors go. And 25 years to the day, the pastor had left his book for the next pastor, who had left it for the next pastor. And that particular pastor called that same gentleman to come forth and stand in the center of the sanctuary. And he said, "Brother, I want you to stand here and give us your personal testimony and witness." And the man looked a bit shocked and he said, "Well, the only thing I can think of is by the grace of God, 25 years ago, I received Jesus Christ as my personal Lord and Savior." And the sanctuary was dead silent. Our Christian witness and testimony is not sufficiently found in recognizing or memorializing the day that we encounter Christ. Our Christian witness and testimony is all the stories, all the events, all the lessons that have come to pass in our life since that day that we took up with Christ, that changed our life, that made that new life in Christ possible. Jesus says to his followers in the first chapter of the Gospel of John, "Because you believe, you will see things greater than these." That's what our witness is called to be about. Those greater things that God has revealed to us, given to us, that our stories and our learned life lessons and experiences might assist us in discerning answers to prayer, in affirmation of faith, or simply a word of encouragement that proclaims, "If God can bring us through this struggle, certainly He can do the same for you." When an individual is asked to share their faith and they respond with, "I don't know what to say," their intentional or unintentional inability to share denies the living element of faith present in that room and the blessing that God has placed upon them. Just as we have heard throughout this series that God calls us to know not only how to pray, but how to pray for and with others, even to pray aloud, or to familiarize ourselves enough with God's word that He might reveal to us what the Bible calls in Daniel the profound and hidden things. God desires for our shared or yoked journey to be one of enlightenment, encouragement, and for those who dare to risk traveling those paths less traveled, the awesome blessing of visions and prophecy and revelation. But these adverbs only become a living part of our life and day-to-day journey when we individually recognize that much the same as our physical bodies, the more we exercise our faith, the more our faith and spiritual health increases. The accompanying characteristics of this experience is the more our faith increases, the more our faith will be challenged. Along with those challenges come the broader horizons and inexpressible potentials which God places before us. The question every Christian above those two primary stages of maturity must answer is, do I wish to see past the challenges and the limitations and the torments that pester some of us in the here and now? Some people like living in misery. I had one parishioner in my first solo church. Every Sunday, this person had a cloud following them everywhere they went. If it was a bright and sunny day, and I would say, "Alma, it's a beautifully bright sunny day," and she'd say, "Not where my sister's living." So I intentionally wrote a sermon for Alma. I had the choir sing the piece, "Forget Your Troubles, Come On, Get Happy." And everybody in the sanctuary was staring at her throughout the sermon. Once we hit about the halfway mark, they knew exactly who that sermon was for. And they all beat a path right up to the back door when the pastor says goodbye to people. And they were waiting for Alma. And she got to the door and she took my hand and she said, "Oh, Pastor, I wish my sister were here to have heard that message. She's such a gloomy Gus." The question we're called to answer is, do we want to get past all that? And if we answer in the affirmative, then we are called personally, individually, not corporately or collectively, we are called individually to dig into God's Word, dig into having a daily prayer life, dig into reading God's Word, not just from point A to point B so you can say, "I read the Bible in a year." Yes, but what did you get out of it? Anyone can read from point A to point B, but without understanding, without reflection, without spending prayerful time to consider what you've just covered, what good will it do us? How will it profit us? Did we hear the promises and the potentials given to us in our scripture reading this morning? The prophet Joel proclaims, "It will come about after this that I will pour out my spirit on all mankind. And your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions." In other words, God speaking through the prophet Joel says, after you've done the things that you need to do to draw close to me, I will enable you to experience your faith in a way that has rarely been seen before. And in Joel's promise to the people, that prophecy came to pass. Jesus himself alludes to this in the 14th chapter of the Gospel of John when he says, "These things I have spoken to you while abiding with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in He will teach you all things." Since the days of Pentecost, by the promise and the saving works of Christ, God has and continues to pour out his Spirit to those who seek to explore the uncharted depths of God's will for their life. And those who walk on this level know that God does not ask those who faithfully seek to journey through life masked with a spiritual blindfold, relying only on others while falling prey to the hazards that lay in our pathway. Years ago, I learned how to work with the blind. My next door neighbor, when I was 5 years old, was 5 years old as well. He was born 1 week after me. He was a preemie. And back in the 50s, they didn't know to tape the child's eyes shut. And he was in an incubator for a good long time, and he became completely blind. So when he reached the ripe old age of 12, he and I signed up for the mobility course at the blind school. They taught him, as well as taught me, how to use a cane. And so we would go out and practice every day in the neighborhood. I was such a good instructor. I walked him into every bush, every tree, every obstacle my little 12-year-old eyes could possibly find. And by the end of that summer, I think he discovered every cuss word that was in the vocabulary of a sailor while telling me what he thought of my instructing abilities. But in addition to that, at the end of that summer, he could ride a bike, he could play basketball, he could climb a tree, he could take a walk through the woods with no assistance whatsoever, and for his final exam, which was for all the students in that class, he had to get on a city bus and go down to the state capitol and pick up a sheet of paper at the front desk and then take it back with him to the school the following day without any assistance. Or if I did assist, I was supposed to rat him out and tell him, I ratted you out. But he did just fine. But what was interesting was the response of people around him. Why is he wearing sunglasses? It's nighttime. Well, he wears them because it makes some people uncomfortable to see blind people's eyes. He's not blind. What do you mean he's not blind? He's riding a bike. Everybody knows blind people can't ride bikes. You see, we have this presumption of what is and is not possible. And the things he was able to do because he was blind made people nervous. Even to this day, he makes people nervous. He tells me, and I laugh a lot, his neighbors get upset. He goes out in the morning, he backs the car out of the garage, he has it in the driveway, he warms it up for his wife, so when she comes out to take them both to work, the car's nice and warm. The neighbors go crazy. There's a blind man backing a car out of the garage down the drive. And everybody knows blind people can't drive. I taught him to drive when I was 18. It was in an empty parking lot, folks. We weren't on public streets. But we have this presumption of what we see and what we believe to be the absolute end of the discussion. And the Bible tells us over and over and over again, in so many various ways, by the power of God's Spirit, we do not have the final authoritative word. God does. But that's hard for some people to accept. And this same idea of doing things beyond our belief is what our passage is speaking about this morning. Both Joel and the Apostle Paul proclaim, when our sight is not limited by humanity and human standards, then we will, by faith, see beyond the norm and discover paths that will enable us to both see and to do things beyond belief. Just as the blind learn to develop physical senses far beyond what any of us will ever do, those who attain that same depth of faith will spiritually develop the ability by the power and the presence of God's Spirit to see, to hear, to know, and to experience things far beyond our limited senses and comprehension. Paul says to the church, I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ, whether in body or out of the body, was caught up to the third heaven. And I know how such a man was caught up into paradise and heard inexpressible words which a man is not permitted to speak. In essence, Paul tells the church, in the depth of your faith, the impossible is surely possible. The ineffable is surely plausible. The questions for us to answer are, how much of God do I truly want to know? Think about a new Christian. We say, are you willing to turn your life over to Christ? The first thing they're thinking is, well, how much am I giving to Christ? And the answer is, all. That's why we sing the song, I Surrender All. That makes a lot of people nervous. Well, can I keep? No, you got to give it all. How much of God do I truly want to know? How spirit-filled and faithful am I willing to become? Our final scripture reading this morning is from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, which reads, when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. In other words, those who are truly spiritual in this life, on this side of eternity, will discover that these spectacular beyond belief abilities are only a minute glimmer of what God has in store for those who would be faithful in the here and now. As we close this series, we recall the levels that we have examined. It's all about me, taught us about a selfish, self-centered love. And we've known people who have never moved past that level of living. The next week reminded us about our love for our immediate family and the struggles that ensue in general, regular, everyday living. Last week reminded us that we have the capacity to love beyond the limits of just our family and our friends. And in our lesson today, we consider the dreams and visions that lead us to a perfecting love that can change our knowledge and perception of everything about us to such a point that we see and know things beyond our current beliefs. For a creative soul provides unique opportunities in giving life gifts. Perfect love flattens the boundaries of life and enables us to care and have a love for people that we have never known. Let us pray. Our Lord, each and every one of us would say, we are not perfect. Some of us feel closer to perfection than others. May your Spirit testify to each of us, not only where we are, but by your love, grace, mercy, and sacrifice already paid, where your love might lead us. Lord, help us to truly be your people, the sheep of your pasture, that we might grow in ways that would enable us not by our own power, but by the strength of your Spirit, to glorify you and to truly know things beyond belief. For we ask these things in Christ's name. And all of God's people said, amen.